Yeah, well, I'm playing a little tag team because Sam comes tomorrow. And so this is the last session I'm going to be doing. And it's been great being here. I just love to come and minister to hungry people. People are pressing in for more of God. And it's just been a blessing, really, is to be here with you. I travel back home early tomorrow morning. I'm marrying two young people in our church. I really thank you for saying young people. But it really is great to have been with you. And I know Sharon wasn't able to come here, but she usually travels everywhere with me. And, you know, we have our daughter's wedding coming up in November. So they've just been doing flowers and all of those things. So, yeah, that's the reason why she's not here. Otherwise, she'd have loved to have been here. And also the church that I'm part of, up in Dudley. They're just a generous church. They released me to come places like this and to be able to go to the nations of the world just to pour in to those places what we poured in at Dudley. And I've just enjoyed doing that over the last couple of days. And I know Sam very well, and Sam is just a wonderful man that carries a terrific anointing upon his life. And what he's done at the Church of Oasis is amazing. And I know he's coming in after me. You'll get to know who was flowing in the Spirit then, won't you? You know, to whether he continues with me or whatever. So you'll be able to tell him afterwards, you know. I just want to mention a couple of things before I share this evening. And that is that we've got some of these magazines out in the other room there. But we have a conference every year called Prophetic Seers. And we started having it a number of years ago when God began to open up the revelatory realms, particularly to me and then to the church. And we're able to have Bobby Connor. Bobby comes in every year and just carries something fresh. In terms of one of those prophetic figures that carry the now word for the church. And he has just been such a blessing. So that's in November 17th to the 20th. It's a three-day conference. And we also put on the front end of that on the Wednesday, a Leaders' Day. And also we have Jason Hooper. If you like Todd Bentley, you'll love Jason Hooper. Jason has been working with Rick Joyner up in Morningstar for a number of years now, and he also has been working very close with Rick and with Todd in the restoration process. And we just felt that we ought to bring a young guy in, Jason Hooper, and so he's going to be with us. And also then, we have a conference at the beginning of every year called The Secret Place. And that's in January, and if I could just get the people there, and also the times, that's January 19th to the 22nd, and we have Paul Keith Davis and Chuck Pierce again with us this year. If you've never heard any of those guys, both of them truly prophetic figures, but also I believe that they help us to position ourselves for the year that we come into. And so that's the Secret Place conference that we have in January. And just those couple of things I wanted to mention. And then, you know, we bring the resources, and that is just so that it flows. I haven't got time to go through everything that God downloads to us over a period of time in Dudley. I come and I try and really be sensitive to what the Holy Spirit wants me to pour out. And there are things that I say in those times that the resources are there to help you after I've gone. And there's just a couple of things I want to mention. Just a series that I've been doing. I'm not a person who does series. You know, God just descends on something and I'll just stay there. And for as long as he's on it. And once he's lifted, that's the series over. And, you know, we've got people in our church who say, you know, you never finished that series. I said, I did. And they said, well, you said there was going to be another two. And I said, well, there isn't. You know, that's it over. And but over the last sort of few weeks, so this is just something God's been doing. And that is looking at conversations that change seasons. And You know, there's a whole lot here. There's one in here about a conversation that changes a season of sickness that results in healing. There's also a season here, in here, of a woman at the well who changes a season of brokenness for men. And the person who she's living with is not her husband. And a season changes because a man starts to minister to her called Jesus. And she begins to see through a conversation that this man is the Messiah. And she becomes one of the greatest evangelists in the Bible, because a whole town come to Christ because of her report. And so there was a season that changed because of one conversation that she had. And then also a season that changes in terms of ministry and in terms of our life's destiny and goal. And I just go through the conversation that Jesus had with Simon Peter. And then I go through a whole lot of things of how God dealt with the Peter so that he could become, dealt with the Simon so that he could become the Peter. And, you know, there's lots of things. Sometimes there's a mixture in us, isn't there? You know, there's what God wants us to be, our destiny, and then there's our history. Well, Peter got a lot of that in him until God dealt with him. He called him and Peter when he first came to him. But then through his life, when it was that he said to Jesus, after Jesus had said to him he was going to the cross, he said, "Not you, Lord." And Jesus said, "Get behind me, Satan, because you don't savor the things of God. You haven't got a taste for the things of God." And then when he says, "If all will betray you, I won't," he says, "Simon, Simon, Satan has desired to have you, though I might sift you as we prayed for you." And then he just took him into a place where he restored him through John, book of John, chapter 21. And I go through the conversation. You see, if you're sick, you need to have a conversation. God wants a conversation. And I take that through the story of Naaman. It was the little girl. Do you remember? And she says to her mistress, "There is a man in Israel who can heal my master of his leprosy." Just a little conversation. And see, in those times when God is speaking to us, we need to be able to discern in a moment. We need to discern in a moment who it is who's speaking to us and the implications of that. And so I go through, there's a whole series there. I think there's one or two more coming on that one. But conversations that change seasons. You ever gone, you know, you're sick, you go to a doctor. If you're feeling healthy, you go to a doctor. And the doctor says, "I'm sorry to say it to you, but you've got cancer." It changes the season in your life from that moment. Things change. You know, there's so much power in the words that we speak. And I just go through a whole thing about the power of the word. So there's that. But also, too, I've been talking about inheritance this morning. And there are things that we receive through inheritance and we never have to war for. And I really brought that out. But I go into it a lot more deeply in terms of David preparing an inheritance for his son Solomon and how he gave him everything. You know, the sometimes that we want to do things, and I just feel that's a real testimony about the heart of David. David being a man after God's own heart. You know, when David said, had it in his heart to build a temple or to build a house for the presence of God, and God, through the prophet Nahum, goes to him and said, "David, you had it in your heart to build it, but you're not the one who's going to do it." Most people, when they hear that, say, "If I can't do it, nobody's going to do it." Right. Isn't that true?
Yeah.
"If I'm not going to do it, nobody's going to do it." David, he took the plans and he gave them to his son, Solomon. Then it says, he gave him instructions of how to build it. And then he took up an offering and gave it to Solomon so that he would have resource. And then it says, finally David took out of his own personal treasury and gave it to Solomon for the building of the temple. You know, and there are things that we receive from inheritance that we will never get through warfare. Some people are trying to go into warfare to get inheritance. No, inheritance is what you get for free. Inheritance is something that you never worked for. Somebody else paid the price so that you can have it. But there's also what we possess through warfare. And sometimes, you see, we get those things mixed up. And I go into it in quite some detail about what we possess through warfare we'll never possess through inheritance, because it's the battles that we fight, that we possess things because of the inheritance that's in our lives. And so how do we receive it, and how do we obtain breakthrough? Because that's the application of it. How do we receive our inheritance? And then how do we then move to a place where we obtain breakthrough? And is anyone here, you just pressing into God for a breakthrough? Anyone here? Just wave to me. Okay, you can have that. You'll be blessed. So we've been yakking a lot today. Well, I have. You've been listening. I just pray that God just takes some of those things and put it in your heart that you can work with, and that works with you and begins to change and transform your lives. But I want to talk this evening in terms of effective doors of ministry. And, if we're to move into revival, you've heard me say right from the beginning, revival is hard work. Angels don't show up. Well, they do, but some of them have got dirty faces, as one of the songwriters wrote a song years ago. But you see, we need to understand that when God begins to revive His church, the church takes on new purpose, and it takes on a new focus of what it is actually here for, and we are the church. And I believe that we are in days. Some people are praying for revival. If you could understand, if you could see the whole plan of God in a moment, you would see that revival isn't something that's going to happen. We are in a time of revival. There are more people coming to Christ in this period of time, in this age, than ever before in history. While we are speaking, in 1 hour, there is 120,000 people will come to Christ. While I'm speaking. You see, just because it isn't happening in our own backyard, we think that revival isn't taking place. And if we understand who the church is, it isn't this group here, it isn't that group. We are the church. We are the church. We have local expressions of it. And there are local congregations that meet to express the vision that God has placed within them. But the church worldwide is growing at a rate that has never happened before. Also, the church is going through incredible persecution. Just because it's not happening to us in our locality, it doesn't mean to say that the church isn't in a time of persecution, and even in a time of tribulation. When Jesus said that, the very elect, there would be a great falling away, that even the elect would fall away. I believe, do you know people who once walked with God, and yet they've fallen away, they've fallen completely away from a place of faith? We're already in those times. And so when we start to look at it, did you know this? Statisticians have said that the church on earth now, this will just blow your mind. The church on earth is larger than the church in heaven. Get hold of that. So there is a cry going up from the church on the earth that is greater than the whole of the gathered church in heaven. Just in the whole population explosion of the last 100 years. And we're seeing populations double every 100 years now. It's not, those things haven't happened before. We are in a time now where the greatest harvest the world has ever known could be brought about in one generation. Yeah. Isn't that awesome? Yeah. Give the Lord a mighty clap. Yeah. We need to understand, we don't have to pray for revival. We can see that we are in revival. There are things that God is doing in these days, like the healing ministry. I mean, just people going out onto the streets and seeing people getting healed, giving prophetic words, speaking destiny into people's lives, giving dream interpretations, all of those things. When was that done in the last 50 years? And yet it's happening. Can you see? I mean, we just need to begin to celebrate the awesomeness of what God is doing through His church. I mean, the church is a glorious church. Yes, I know it's got a few wrinkles, it has a few spots, but listen, all those are going to get wiped, washed out and all pressed out. You know, when Jesus comes back, He's not coming to this whimpering church that's on its last legs, ready to die. He's coming for a radiant bride that is fitting for Him. Fitting for Him who will be radiant. There will not be the creases, the wrinkles, the spots and the blemishes. He will come for that radiant bride. See, we need to understand that so that we can get hold of what it is to live in revival. You know, just because we're not seeing the multitudes, but listen, if you could go to different places, go up to the pastor who's here, Pastor Barrett, who's been here, if you go up to his, I've seen the pictures, just go and look at the pictures out there. People coming to Christ. If you come with me next week, or if you were able to come with me next week, you will see literally thousands of people come to know Christ. Thousands of people in a matter of days come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. You'll see that this church is being planted out of effective ministry. What is that? People getting healed, going back into Buddhist communities. Let me just tell you this one story. There was this young man who came. I didn't even know that he was there, but they said to me I had prayed for him. I have no recollection of praying for him. But I was up in Gangtok the first time. That's just on the Tibetan-Indian border, right up in one of the states called Sikkim. And we'd gone up there, and we were having this meeting, and two young girls, when I say young, they were 16-year-olds. They went into the hospital because there was a young man in there dying with tuberculosis. It had gone into his bones. And he was just riddled with tuberculosis. He was down to less than 5 stones in weight. I mean, he was just emaciated. And to get him out of the hospital, this is faith. To get him out of the hospital, the two girls signed the book to take him out of the hospital. But not only that, they took him a change of clothes. So they put clothes on him. And on his hospital garments, they took clothes for him to wear. And then they brought him to the meeting. And I was preaching on healing and the healing anointing. And they say that they put him onto the platform. They just carried him there and put him onto the platform. They did say to me that I did pray for him. I have no recollection of ever praying for him. Anyway, after the meeting, they took the boy and they took him back to his village, not to the hospital. See, that's how faith works. The reason they put clothes on him was because they said he wasn't going back to the hospital after he got prayer. And so they took him back up, right up into the hills. You get to Gangtok, which is about a 4-hour jeep drive from the nearest airport. You go right up into the hills. And then from Gangtok, it's another 3 hours just over rugged terrain, off-road, in a jeep. And then you walk, because I've been there, you walk about the last couple of miles because there's no other way in. And so he went back up there. And it's a Buddhist stronghold. Let me tell you, don't believe what the Buddhists say, that they are this wonderful, peaceful religion. I mean, they persecute Christians more than any other group in that region. When I say persecute, they beat people, they refuse to teach the children, and they're the only schools there. They refuse people to be part of communities. They ostracize people in order to put pressure on them in order to stay Buddhist. And so they went back up there, and after a week, he put on 4 stone in weight. And And so what happened one week, brought four stones away. Not only that, but people were saying to him, well, how is this happening? And so he would just tell people that he'd gone to a meeting and Jesus Christ had healed him. And so what happened, after 3 weeks, they called down, the two girls called down to Pastor Daniel, it's the person I work with out there, and they said, will you come up to our village? He says, I can't make it for a while. They said, no, you must come up this weekend because we've already arranged a meeting and we have 40 people in our village coming to the meeting because they want to know about the Jesus who healed this young man. And so he went up there. Out of that meeting, 20 of them became Christians there and then and requested that they be baptized in water in the town. Not anywhere else, in the town. So everybody could see that they were becoming Christians. See, just because of a sign and a wonder of healing, a church was planted. I believe that is going to happen more and more, even in Western nations. Even in Western nations. The people are going to start together. Why? Because the Western world is bankrupt. It is insufficient. It thought that it was self-sufficient. It could sort out all the problems, but it can't. And it's come back to bite us. But I believe that's God's way of just saying, church, are you ready? Church, are you positioning yourselves to minister to the broken, to the poor, to the people who lost everything? And listen, it's not the down and outs. These are going to be senior leaders who lose everything. These are going to be people who have been on 60 plus thousand pounds a year salary that's going to lose everything, losing their homes. You see, we need to start realizing that we are the ones who have an answer to the world's problems. Instead of being part of the problem, we need to offer to them a God who is able to heal. You know, the whole thing in terms of the health system, see, we need to realize that we've got to get that anointing upon our lives because the health system can't cope with all the pressures that are being put on. And then what do? Is we begin to target certain groups. So we target the weakest. That's what the world does. We target the weakest. We target those that we feel should not be here. So then we make an attack on the illegal immigrants. You know, I used to have a view about that till I heard. Do you know Matthew Ashimaloa in London? Have you heard of him?
Yes.
KICC. Yes. He has a church there of thousands of people. I think it was about 20,000 people. And a third of his church are illegal immigrants. Wow. And I thought, goodness me, you know, he needs to be doing something about that. And until I was talking to someone, he said, you know, isn't it great? Wouldn't you rather have, you know, 2,000 or 3,000 illegal immigrants attending church than running around the streets?
Yeah.
I mean, I was sold out then, thinking, bring them in, God. See, but we've got this prejudice all the time. See, what we do, we focus in on the weakest people. We need to start positioning ourselves and seeing that the church really is an answer to the social problems, to the physical problems of the people in this world. And the thing is, we get it for free because it's all about Him and it's all God does. He touches our lives. You know, for me, I'm gone out of here tonight, so listen. But I just trust that tomorrow night you take up the biggest offering that's ever offered here. Really, you just take it up. Why? To bless, if for nothing else, to bless the pastor who's come here from the north of India. Listen, if you were to go, you probably wouldn't last 6 months living with the conditions he lives in. You know, we need to start seeing that we are so resourceful. God has given us so much. You know, and I'm not talking about just putting the odd pound in or something like that. There's some people here who could put £1,000 in easily. And it wouldn't even make that much difference to the way you lived your life. Can you see? We just need to start thinking the thoughts of God.
Yeah.
See, if you've got a heart for revival, revival is costly.
Yeah.
If you don't believe me, Read Acts chapter 6. People sold their possessions. No man counted anything was their own any longer. It was all for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Some of them sold possessions and came and brought the proceeds and laid it at the apostles' feet to dispose of it as they will. No strings attached. And out of that, the poor were fed. Out of that, there were citywide revivals. Out of that, the gospel spread to the then known Roman world. I mean, just incredible things that just took place. Can you see? Just so tomorrow night, just come with a real heart to say, God, I just need to get onto your plan of action. And I'm going to do something that you've never done. Give an amount tomorrow night that you've never given before. For no other reason than just to do it. Because you've never done that before. Do something new. Be a pioneer. Understand? Start thinking differently. You know? And just do it. Say, God, I've never given this much before. It scares the spit out of me. Well, that's okay. You know, God loves it when you do that. You know, when you just get to a point where you just don't know, God, what am I doing this for? And you think, for me. But do something tomorrow night that you've never done before. An amount that you've never given before. You know, just send the whole thing through the roof. Huh? Wouldn't that be good?
Yeah.
I mean, he can spend it. He'll get rid of it. He'll get rid of it in the right ways. You know? Because I know his heart. I know his heart is to bless.
Yeah.
You know, but we need to understand that, you know, let's get into. Let us get in. If God is pouring out this anointing that the church is being revived, don't you think we ought to get in on it?
Yes.
It's not that we're saying, God, revive the church. God's saying, well, come on in, get in on it.
Yes.
Get in on the action.
Huh?
Yeah, because we look at things so microscopically. You know, we just see our own little things going on. We see all the stuff that's going on. And we think, God, we need revival. God's saying, I'm already doing it. Just get onto my program. You know, it really does work. It is for you. It isn't so you have to keep praying. It says this. If your earthly father knows how to give good gifts to his children. You know, if you go to your father and you ask him for bread, will he give you a stone? If you ask him a fish, will he give you a serpent or a scorpion? How much more will your heavenly father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask? Isn't the Spirit of God the Spirit of revival? He comes to put life where there's death. Isn't that revival? That which was alive, that was dead, he comes and he breathes on it. It comes to life.
Amen.
You know, awesome things happen. Now turn to Revelation chapter 3. No, and I'm not going down into Laodicea. You know, aren't you glad?
Yes.
Huh? Yes. I mean, how many times have we heard about Laodicea? You know, poor, wretched, pitiful, blind. We sort of walk out of the church, you know, crestfallen, thinking, oh, no, you know, thinking we've got to do a whole lot of stuff. And, but I want to read to you about the church of Philadelphia. The lovers of the brothers. That's what the word means. The church here. They were the lovers of the brothers. Philadelphos. That's what it means. That filial love. That love in terms of what friends would give to one another. Just out of relationship. Not out of it because they would have to, because they were family. This is about friends coming together. Jesus called his disciples friends. You heard me speak about that this afternoon. But here it is, friends who come together and they love one another. And this is what it says. One of the churches that there are no black marks on its record. Awesome. See, God always has a remnant. He always has something that he can hold up and say, this is what you can become. All the way through history. He's never been without a testimony. It is awesome. These are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the key of David. We're going to look at that in a while. What he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. I know your deeds. See, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. I will make those who are of the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though they are not, but are liars, I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you. Since you have kept my commands to endure patiently, I will also keep you from the hour of trial. Isn't that awesome? This church. And it says, and that is going to come upon the whole world to test those who live on the earth. I am coming soon. Hold on to what you have, so no one will take your crown. He who overcomes, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Never again will he leave it. That's us. That's what we, never again will we leave it. Unbroken communion with the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, what will that be like? You know, we haven't got all those things pressing in. Hold on to what you have received. God, what is coming? I'm coming soon. Hold on to what you have so no one will take your crown. Him who overcomes, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Never again will he leave it. I will write on him a name of my God and the name of the city of the God, the New Jerusalem, which is coming down out of heaven from my God. And I will also write on him my new name. He who has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the church. Oh, what a glorious church. Little strength, but keeps on patiently enduring. You know, knowing what it is. Operating in that spirit of discernment so they knew who were not Jews, even though they said they were, because they were of the synagogue of Satan. So they had discernment taking place. They had the ability to hold on to what they had achieved up to that point. And God was not going to not reward them for the things that they'd done. That they were effective in ministry. He knew their good deeds. See, I believe that God wants to reward us. He wants to reward you and me for the things that we do. And so here in this church, it talks here of how could they then minister out of that place. It says here, I know your deeds. What he opens, no one can shut. What he shuts, no one can open. I know your deeds. See, I have placed before you an open door. See, we need to understand tonight. We need to understand that God is the God of the open door. It says here, first of all, what he opens, no man can shut. And what he shuts, no one can open. He is just using that as an illustration to reveal to us the power that he has above human power. So, any door he opens, no one can shut. Any door he shuts, no one can open. And then he says, behold, look, hey, wake up. I have placed before you an open door. And then he goes on to say, I know your deeds. I place before you an open door that no one can shut, and I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word. See, I believe that we've got a God of the open door. He wants to open doors for you to move into effective ministry. It says here, he's put on him the keys of David. Did you know that David never had anything, even the tent that he had to place the ark in was an open-sided tent. He did something different. He did something different because up until that time it had been kept in the tabernacle. When David brought the ark into Jerusalem, it was an open-sided tent. And for the first time in Israel's history, they could all look upon the glory presence of Jesus, of God in the ark. Up until then, it was covered over. David opens something up. And so here, when it talks to him about having the key of David and what he opens, no one can shut. What he shuts, no one can open. See, I believe we need to look at it. He didn't have a physical key. What I believe is the key of David are the anointings that he carried upon his life in order to bring the people of God back to a place where they could, with open face, behold the glory of God. And so there was even that testimony in the Old Testament of them being able to see the glory of God. Up until that point, it had been covered over. Seeing David was a man that carried anointing upon his life. He was the most anointed people. And I believe the key for effective ministry, or the key for the door of effective ministry, is the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We need that anointing upon us, because He is the only one who can effect ministry that is effective. He's the only one who can bring it about. He's the one that comes upon us. And the thing is that David, he was the most anointed man in the Old Testament. Apart from Jesus, I believe he was the most anointed man. It says of David, he was anointed 3 times. See, in those 3 areas of his anointing. In those 3, you thought I didn't use my notes, didn't you? But in those 3 areas of anointing, see, every anointing that God puts upon your life, it's to give you a new sphere of influence. Every anointing that He puts upon you is to increase your authority. Every anointing that He puts upon you is to give you access to new things. That's why He puts the anointing upon you. And here, see, a key is a symbol of those things. When you have a key, you have access, don't you? If I were to give you the keys to my car, it would mean that you have access to my car. If I had the insurance, you could drive my car. Sometimes my daughters think that they have a key to get in our home. And they think that they have access to it at any time. Now, the fact is, they do, otherwise I wouldn't have given the key. But you know, you can come home from being away for 3 weeks, and you go into the house, the fridge is empty, because they've been round. Neither of them live there anymore. The fridge is empty. They've used my wood pile that I stopped near the back door, because they've been having, you know, going over to our home, because it's a nicer home to have an open fire. And so they think, well, Mum and Dad said let's go and enjoy. You know, you go in to get some chocolate, all the chocolate's gone. You know, and then sometimes they've even phoned us up and said, this is when we've been in India, they phoned us up and said that, isn't there any chocolate in the house? I'm thinking, not alive, you know. But you see, a key gives someone access to things. See, when God places upon us anointing, it's to give us access to those things. But also a key speaks of ownership. I wouldn't expect my daughters to do anything other than what they do. Really, I mean that. Because if they have a key and they never go in and they never see what's in the house is theirs, then I have kept so much from them. Yes. See, when they go into our house, they own what's in there. You know, and sometimes I let them know, be careful with how you're using all of this, because it is your inheritance. Learn well now. You know, we've been in a place where we've had the privilege of helping our daughters so that we... See, I don't want them to enjoy all the inheritance when I'm dead. I want to see them enjoying it. Do you understand? Some of us are older. We need to start blessing our children now. Find ways to do it. It is possible. We prove that. So that they come into a place where they own it and it's theirs. Do you understand? Yeah. My generation, in that sense, we weren't left that much. But you know what? I am more affluent or far richer than my father. He was far richer than his father. Do you understand? Yes. Why? Because there's inheritance. But, you know, my father worked all his life. He has a small house, you know, and that's it. He hasn't been able to. But I've been in a place where I've made those sacrifices in order to give my girls, the 2 girls, and now our grandchildren. Let me tell you, it just gets, you know, you think you're okay when they leave home, it just gets more. Yeah. It really does. They're just, you know, wising you up. Some of you smiling at me, you know. Just, yeah. Yeah, but then the thing is, you go out and you, you know, this is what you do. You start buying things, you know, and you take them home for the grandchildren. And then the girls say, Dad, you never did that for me. And then you have to go out and buy them something too, you know. So it just gets expensive, but that's all about ownership. See, when you have a key, you become owners. I wouldn't expect them to do anything different. When God gives us the key, when God puts anointing upon us, it's so we can have ownership of all the resources of heaven. Mm-hmm. The thing is, we think we have to do something in order to get it. I believe God wants to release it to us.
Yeah.
And he doesn't say there are no go areas in his house. See, we think that. We think that there's no go areas. Well, that's for that person. That person can go there. That person gets blessed in that way. It's just that they believe what God says. When he says that we've been given an inheritance, we've been given the deposit guaranteeing our full inheritance. See, that's the Holy Spirit. He's a deposit guaranteeing our full inheritance. The thing is, because Jesus died, the will has been made. Yes. We have the full inheritance now.
Amen.
For us to use wisely to see the kingdom of heaven, the rule and reign of God, increase and not decrease.
Amen.
See, that's why he's put the anointing upon our lives.
Yes.
Also, with anointing, when you have a key, it gives you authority. When you have a key, it gives you influence. Those are just things that come. With the anointing, I believe God wants to give us authority and he wants to give us influence. See, what about the sphere of your influence? See, God wants to increase it. What about the sphere of your authority? God wants to increase it. What about the sphere of power? God wants to increase it. You know, there's times when, you know, I prayed for people with bad backs and then God uses me to pray for somebody. When I say pray, just to declare healing. Just to declare healing and somebody gets out of wheelchairs. You know, I start to pray with people who've got eye problems. I can remember praying for people with conjunctivitis. And then one day, a woman brought a baby to one of our meetings and the baby had no eyes. And said, would you pray for my baby? It was 2 days old. Would you pray for my baby? I didn't know what she had first. It was wrapped up in all of these garments. And as I took it, there was a baby. There was no slits, no nothing, no eyes. Just sealed down. And I just put my two fingers on this little baby's eyes. And I just spoke a creative miracle. The next day she came to see me. See, increasing of spheres. See, that's why we need the anointing. And this baby, they brought this baby. I looked at this baby and this woman was just beside herself with joy. Because now there were two slits and there were two eyes the size of peas. And they were growing as you looked at them. And then she said, would you dedicate my baby? And she said, would you give him a name? And I called this little baby Elijah. Because he was a seer. And you know, just things like that. But it started when I prayed for people with conjunctivitis, and I just kept praying for them. You know, sometimes I've given out words of knowledge because the only word I know, and people just come and respond. Sometimes, you know, we just need to wise up. See, we say, don't we, sing that prayer or sing that song, what he's done for others, he can do for you. Sometimes I go through words of knowledge and all I'm doing is telling people the word of knowledge is what God's healed me of. And as I say, people respond and then they start getting healed. God healed me of a prolapsed mitral valve. I mean, I pray for prolapsed mitral valves and ping, they go straight back into place. You know, things like that. I had problems with my back where they're going to have to fuse my spine together because of the pain that I was in. And God healed me. I was the first person to get healed in the healing revival that we had back in 2001. I was the first person. I stood up and said, that's me. Pray for me. And I was totally healed. And I've never had any problem with it since. And I've traveled the world in economy class, cattle truck class, any other class that's there. I've traveled and bouncing around. I realized that people in India, now they sort of are like this, that's because of their roads. Really is. Because of their roads, I'm quite sure. No other reason. You know? And you go out there, In Apua, you start doing this too. I'm glad it comes off me when I get home because the roads are flat. You know? But there's anointing. See, God wants to increase your sphere. How does he do it? First of all, is this. See, there's an anointing. David had a personal anointing in his life. He was anointed personally. And his influence was within his own family. We need to have an anointing where we see that anointing operating in our own families. Listen, we need to start calling every family member back. I've been praying. Mm-hmm. Some of you heard last night. I've been praying for my dad for 37 years. He became a Christian on Sunday. I had the privilege of leading him to Jesus. Now, come on, that deserves a big shout. You can clap me because I want all the help I can get. My other relatives, I have two sisters and a brother. Neither of them are born again. I was the only one in my family until last week. Now my father's with me. Now we can start praying together. Can you see? But there's an anointing for our families. We need to see that God wants families saved. That's his purpose. Yes. We need to start claiming them. But also we need to start speaking to them. You know, I can remember, 37 years I preached the gospel to my dad the first time I got home, having been in a Christian drug rehabilitation center. And I've been watching the Billy Graham Faith in Fact films. Did you ever see those things? And then Billy Graham would get to speak at the end of it. That's what I was brought up on. You know, that was my Tuesday night and Thursday night television viewing in the rehab center. And so we were brought up on that. And every time, the end of the meeting, end of the Fact in Faith film, Billy Graham would show up and he would preach a simple message. And then he would ask people, you're here tonight that you can receive the Lord Jesus Christ. You just have to come as you are. You can come as you are and you can receive the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, I went home having just had 6 months of this. So we were sat at the dinner table and I get up from the dinner table and I preach the gospel. I mean, I thought that's what you should do. So I stand up and I preach the gospel. And then, just as Billy Graham did, I'm all the way through and saying, listen, there's going to be an opportunity, Mom and Dad. I did. You ask my dad, he'll tell you. There's going to be an opportunity where you can ask the Lord Jesus Christ to be your personal Savior. And so I preached a little bit more. And then I said again, and in a moment, I'm going to stop, and you can receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. So, I mean, I thought that's what you did. So after I finished, I says, now, Mom and Dad, is all you have to do is just stand up to receive the Lord Jesus Christ. You think I'm kidding? I mean, I did. I mean, I was on, you know, holding on to the table as I was preaching, you know, like this. I've got rid of some of those ways now, but like this, so, you know, looking at them, eyeball to eyeball, so they knew I wasn't talking about anybody else, and there was only two of them in the room. And so they're not responding, so I go on again. So all you've got to do is stand. Well, after about 15 minutes of this, I think they both stood up just to get me to shut up. You know, I did, you know. Because my dad, you know, he just continued to live the way that he did. And they never really had many more Sunday lunches after that with me around. You know? I wonder why. But you see, there's an anointing. But just last week, this is what my dad said to me. He said, you waited a long time for this, haven't you, Trev? I said, yes, 37 years. And then he just started to weep and I just wept with him. It was just awesome. And then his face just glowed, and I was going back home to the grandson's dedication, and he said, oh, I think I'll stay here a little bit at church. He'd already been there 2 hours. I think I'll stay here a bit. Now, these seem nice people. I mean, he's been there a few times, but then he was going, everybody was just loving on him.
Yeah.
You know, then he went to the coffee shop. I think I'm going to go to the coffee shop. He got some good coffee in there. So he goes in there. He comes home an hour later. Glowing. You know? See, we need an anointing for our families. That's where we need to see revival breaking out. You know, and he came to see me this week. He hasn't been to see me as often as he has this last week. He came on Sunday, then he came again midweek. And I put it on Facebook to all friends who I know. And I mean, I've just had loads of people, the highest responses or comments made with my dad's salvation. And so I said, here, Dad, let me read you some of the things that people are saying about you getting saved on Sunday. I said, this one's from America. His eyes nearly popped out of his head. You know, this person's in America. And I just said, oh, it's wonderful that your dad has saved. And I said, this one's from New Zealand. He said, do they know this all over the world? I said, oh, yes. I said, you are a marked man now, Dad. Everybody knows, you know. But you see, we need to make the gospel so fun for people. We really do. We need to make it so that when people accept it, they know that they are accepting the greatest gift that is possible for a person to receive. You know, to tell a person that they're a dirty, low-down, rotten sinner and going to hell, it might be the truth, but it doesn't sound like good news. Does it? And that's what we say to lots of people. You know, we need to start lightening up a bit because God is very light. You know, Jesus, he talks to a woman at a well, starts talking to her about worship. We'd be talking to her about getting her life sorted out, getting rid of all these men in their lives, getting rid of the spirit of adultery, spirit of, you know, separation, all of those things. That's what we'd start up, isn't it? Jesus, he starts to talk to about worship. I'm thinking, Jesus, you've got a whole different view of things than me. And I know it's not you that's going to change. You know? And so we just need to really start lighting up, making the good news sound like good news in people's lives. See, that's what revival is. Telling them that it isn't a demand. God is offering it to us. Telling them that there are glorious benefits that are obtainable now, not just when we die. See, that's what the gospel is all about. See, there's an anointing. David carried an anointing over his own personal life. And that anointing, you see, the spheres of influence. Can you see? It grows with the anointing. He can kill a lion because he goes after a sheep. Then he kills a bear. I mean, how would you? When you've got a bear mane in your hands, because the bear is after your sheep, and you've taken hold of the mane of that lion, lion. When you've got a lion's mane in your hands, you are committed to dealing with it. Notice that? You really are. I mean, it's either him or me. You know? But you see, that anointing increased. Hi, Grace. Hi, Sam. Good to see you. I get a really good report. I get a good report about you, Sam. I did. See, he's here now. Huh? See what you honor, you attract. He was coming tomorrow.
That's the last I heard anyway, he was coming tomorrow.
So, and, you know, but he kills a lion, then he kills a bear. And you go from lions and bears to a 9-foot giant. Can you see?
Yeah.
Now his influence is going to increase. And so, see, all that God does in our lives is to increase that anointing. And he goes from that place, you see, from family. And then, that's in 1 Samuel 16. In 2 Samuel 2, verse 4, it's the tribe of Judah that comes and anoint him as leader over the tribe of Judah. See, God wants to increase our influence. He wants to increase our authority. And he wants to increase the power that we carry on our lives. He really does. Yes. So that we can step into what God is doing, which is reviving his church. Amen. And it's not something that we're crying out to God for. God is reviving his church. Oh. When you start to hear what God's doing in the churches, even in this country, it is awesome what he's doing. We just need to start celebrating it. Amen. Instead of tearing one another down because God is doing some amazing things in churches, whether they're large churches or small churches. You know, God is just blessing the church at this moment. But he took on this anointing for this tribe, and then he went from the tribe in 2 Samuel chapter 5. He goes there, and the whole of Israel came together and anointed him king. And the first thing he does in 2 Samuel 5, and you've heard me touch on this, he then goes, because a king needs a place to rule from. And he goes down, just read it, he goes down to the city of the Jebusites. Here it is. It says, when the elders of Israel came to David, King David at Hebron, the king made a compact with them at Hebron before the Lord, and they anointed David king over the whole of Israel. David was 30 years old when he became king, and he reigned for 40 years. In Hebron he reigned over Judah for 7 years and 6 months, and in Jerusalem he reigned over all Israel for 33 years. And then it says, verse 6, the king and his men marched to Jerusalem to attack the Jebusites who lived there. The Jebusites said to David, you will not get any, even the blind and the lame will ward you off, they thought. They thought. It's how wrong you can be. David cannot get in here. Nevertheless, David captured the fortress of Zion, the city of David. And it says, and David took up residence in the fortress, and he called it the city of David, and he built terraces around it. And it says, and from that time, it was called the city of David. Right up until now, it's been called the same name. See, his influence increased. See, the key of David was to open doors for influence and for an increase of authority and for an increase to release the power of the kingdom of God in his day. And I believe that God wants to anoint us tonight. It says here, what does, I have opened up, there's an effective door of ministry that we read there in the book of Revelation. In the book of Revelation it says here, I have opened, I have opened, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. I know your deeds. See, there is doors opening to us for us to do the works of God. But what does an effective door of ministry look like? I believe if you turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 16 verse 8, it says there that an effective door, Paul is speaking about going to Macedonia, it says an effective door of ministry has been opened to me, and there are many who oppose me. And then he talks about praying for me. And he says, I must stay in Ephesus. Is it Ephesus? Yes. I must stay in Ephesus until the Pentecost. And so when you turn then to Acts chapter 19, that is the continuation of 1 Corinthians 16. Because now he finds himself here in Acts chapter 19 at Ephesus at that particular time. And this is what an effective door of ministry looks like. This is what revival looks like. See, because if it's an effective door, God is doing things. If God is doing things, he is breathing life into things. And these are some things. This is what I want to leave with you. This is what I want to pray over you tonight. That God would open to you effective doors of ministry. I believe there's going to be an increase of anointing coming upon your life. And it will increase if you use it. If you don't, you'll lose it. That's just how it is. See, we need to use everything that God gives to us. We may not be the sharpest knife in the drawer, but let me tell you this. If God is putting anointing upon you, you have more than enough of what you need. God will make up everything else. But it says here, chapter verse 1, Apollos was at Corinth and Paul took the road through the interior to Ephesus. So we know the journey that he's been on, from going from Corinth, and he comes to Ephesus. And there he found some disciples. He asked them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? They answered, no, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit. Paul asked them, then what baptism did you receive? John's baptism, they replied. And Paul said, John's baptism was a baptism of repentance. He told the people to believe in the one who is coming after him, that is in Jesus. On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of Jesus. When Paul placed his hands upon them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke in tongues, and they prophesied, and there were about 12 men in all. Mark that down. 12 men, that's all. Yeah. Group of people. You see, with an effective door of ministry, there is a supernatural release of the Holy Spirit. See, if we're to have an effective door of ministry, it is because there has been a release of the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit upon our lives. I cannot understand at times why people say we don't need to speak in tongues, because that's what happened. It was the initial evidence of speaking in tongues. I don't know what you've heard, but let me tell you this. The Bible says that when people were filled with the Holy Spirit, they spoke in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. I want a biblical experience of God, don't you?
Yes.
I'm not talking about, well, you don't need to do that, you don't need to speak in tongues, you can prophesy, all the rest of it, you know, the Holy Spirit's in you, all those things. No, when they got prayer to receive the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit gave a sign through speaking in tongues. Now listen, how many here would want to know the mysteries of God? How many people want to know mysteries of God? See, you just need to speak in tongues. I've got you. You walked into that pretty quick. You see? Because he says in chapter 1 Corinthians 14, I think it's in verse 4, it says that he who speaks in an unknown tongue utters mysteries in the Spirit. So that's why I love it when we start singing in the Spirit. Because what I'm doing is we're singing in the Spirit. I'm just saying, God, I want you to reveal to me the mysteries that you are opening up into this group of people at this time. I want to know the mysteries. The mysteries of the kingdom of God. And all the mysteries are found in the Lord Jesus Christ. So I'm saying to God, God, I want you to reveal Jesus to me in a new way. Because I want to know the mystery of Christ in me, the hope of glory. That's a mystery. How many of you want to see your faith enlarged and built up? See, again, you need to pray in the Spirit to be able to do that. Jude 1 verse 20 says, he who prays, build yourself up in your most holy faith, praying in the Spirit. Your spirit is built up. Why? Because the Bible tells me. Every time you speak in tongues, the Bible says you build yourself up in your most holy faith. Isn't that awesome? That's why he's given us the gift of tongues. So we draw on the mysteries of heaven. We draw on building ourselves up in our most holy faith. Because God wants us bigger on the inside than we are on the outside. You know, but there is an effective door of ministry, is a supernatural release of the Holy Spirit.